July 24th, 2010. Hundreds of thousands of people flooded Duisburg to celebrate Love Parade, one of the world's biggest techno music festivals. Too large to handle. With pressure from all sides, things came to a standstill.
21 reported dead so far.
In a stampede at a German music festival, police said it happened after panic broke out at an entrance tunnel, the Love Parade Festival, which is being held in the city of Duisburg.
Charges of negligent homicide are being investigated.
Early morning on December the 8th, 2017. Court spokesman Matthias Breidenstein is on his way to Düsseldorf, where one of the largest court cases in post-war Germany begins today. The investigation into the Love Parade disaster in Duisburg. Will the trial bring long-awaited answers? Will it deliver justice?
Breidenstein, guten Tag.
Breidenstein speaking. Good morning.
Yeah. Es sind insgesamt 10 Angeklagte.
There are 10 defendants in total. 6 are employees of Duisburg City Council. And 4 are from the events organizing company.
Das sind also die 10 Leute, die 10 Angeklagten.
The 10 defendants are currently represented by 32 defense lawyers, and we have over 60 joint plaintiffs.
Benjamin Satori, our local reporter in Düsseldorf, is on the scene. The trial begins at 9:30 a.m. What's happening now?
Well, the parking lot in front of the exhibition hall has just opened. Journalists from around the world are going to be here. The victims of the Love Parade came from countries including the Netherlands, Italy, Spain, and China. The Love Parade case file is so large that it was brought here by a truck a few days ago. No kidding. It has over 50,000 pages and more than 1,000 annex folders.
It's now 17 minutes to 7. The atmosphere at the Love Parade in Duisburg 7 years ago must have been as cheerful as that last song. It stands in stark contrast to today, when hundreds of people are waiting for the trial to finally begin. Who was responsible for the deaths of 21 young people who never came home? We heard from one mother who lost her son at the Love Parade, Gabriela Müller.
It's not about revenge. It's about getting answers. I want to be taken seriously. I'm not looking for revenge. I just want to make peace with it. And I can only do that if it's resolved.
We heard there from Gabi Müller, and back when Duisburg's district court initially rejected the case, she started an online petition. And she's appearing here today as a joint plaintiff. Her son, Christian, was 25 years old when he simply wanted to enjoy himself at the Love Parade, but was crushed to death in the crowd.
This will be an enormous challenge. If the trial does not end by July 2020, the statute of limitations will expire, and it won't be possible to sentence any of the defendants.
Mm-hmm.
As a father, I want to be there for my daughter at the best and worst of times, especially today. We're talking about the deaths of many people here, about many who were injured at an event which had already attracted a lot of public attention. My aim as a defense lawyer is to demonstrate why my client doesn't bear any criminal responsibility in this case.
This must be emotional for you, right?
It's emotional, but it's just another step after what we went through in July 2010. When the Spanish consulate in Düsseldorf called us to tell us our daughter had died. After we had to identify her mortal remains at the morgue in Duisburg, after we brought her home to Spain in a coffin, that was very hard.
I've seen they've set up large screens in the courtroom to show some footage that's often disturbing of the disaster. It will be difficult for the parents present, but many of them hope that the Love Parade disaster will finally be thoroughly examined.
Please enter for the case against Dressler et al.
Good morning. Please be seated.
The story of this trial begins 7.5 years after the Love Parade disaster and 2.5 years before the statute of limitations expires. 200 days of court hearings are scheduled.
Ultimately, this was a disaster which must now be investigated as a criminal case. Above all, the court must ask, are the defendants guilty of the charges? How large is any individual culpability? That's the court's mandate.
On the afternoon of the first hearing, Chief Prosecutor Mühlhoff reads out the indictment.
Due to the defendant's inadequate and negligent planning, authorization, implementation, and monitoring of the Love Parade 2010, 21 individuals were killed and at least 652 injured. When I read out the indictment, the room went silent. You could feel how people quieted down, even though the room was full, and how many people were affected by it. Some cried. We had to keep away from that emotional level and maintain an objective, rational, legal tone, which isn't always easy. That evening, we were all exhausted.
I think this was a very good start and that the court did a good job. And to be honest, the defense has been very measured in the trial so far. I hope it stays that way.
Of course, the defense must ask all the questions it considers necessary for the investigation. Leaving out questions to be accommodating or to speed up the process is not an option, even though the court would understandably prefer this.
In a preliminary discussion that took place before the first hearing, and particularly given the various interests at play, I told everyone involved, be tough but fair.
We'll come here for as long as we can. It breaks our hearts, but we have no other choice. For us, each one of these steps takes us closer to eternity. Where Clara is now. This was the last place she saw. We think that she walked up here. That's why we keep coming back.
Maybe it's silly, but
we're reunited with her here, thinking of her. It's the last place on Earth where she was alive.
Let's do some more practice with fractions. You meet some colorful characters at the love parade, people you wouldn't meet in a teacher's lounge. When I was 18 and old enough to decide for myself what I wanted, I went to Berlin. I partied at the love parade for the first time in 2001 and returned again in the years after. It was all a pretty magical experience for me.
More than 50 trucks and floats, packed with sound equipment, 250 DJs and lots of dancers, drawing a cross-section of society, all ages and styles, leading the largest dance party on Earth, through Tiergarten Park in the heart of Berlin.
I was really excited that it was about to begin, that we could soon enter the grounds. I chanted along with the others when they started singing Seven Nation Army. Nothing in that tunnel hinted at what was about to happen.
Good morning, please be seated.
Also, als ich aus dem Tunnel rauskam,
when I left the tunnel, there were only two directions to go, either straight ahead or to the right. There weren't any real signs, nothing that said, like, this way to the main area or exit. There was nothing like that at all. So I stood there and then walked towards the staircase with the rest of the crowd. Once some people were up the stairs, I thought, okay, this can't be happening. And from the moment I filmed that woman who went up the stairs and started crying at the top, it was clear to me that things were going very, very wrong. That was the key moment for me. Hopefully we'll all be okay. The people in the middle of it were just trying to survive after a certain point. You can't blame anyone in that situation for their behavior.
Guck mich an! Guck mich an! Guck mich an! Halt durch!
Bitte helfen Sie mir doch!
Kann ich.
Bitte!
Du schaffst es, okay?
Polizei!
Oh? Du schaffst es!
And then 3 to 5 minutes later, suddenly the crowd just cleared. Everybody walked away and there was space.
The
first thing I saw were these two people lying on the ground who I needed to resuscitate. I tried to give them mouth to mouth, but they didn't wake up again. I have this image of a battlefield afterwards, where I saw people dead or severely injured, and where I had the feeling that they had walked in alive with me, and now they were lying here dead. That's what I've had to learn to live with. Just this thought of why.
Traffic researcher and security expert Professor Jürgen Gerlach will be present at every hearing. The prosecution has tasked him with investigating the causes of the disaster. His final report will number over 3,800 pages.
I've considered all possible methods of prevention. The question is, what are we talking about? Are we talking about this exact disaster there and then? Or are we talking about the potential for any disaster on that day? You have to differentiate carefully between the two. But to prevent a disaster on that day, the event would have had to be cancelled. The grounds were simply not suitable for the concept or the flow of people, and had a limited capacity. The risk was high from the outset.
Morning. You have radio number 31. Morning.
Morning.
You have radio number 21.
On the 28th day of the trial, a witness is called whose testimony has been eagerly awaited. Adolf Sauerland, mayor of Duisburg at the time of the tragedy.
Hello.
Many joint plaintiffs and members of the public wonder why he's not in the dock himself.
Adolf Sauerland war ja bis dahin ein relativ.
Until the disaster, Adolf Sauerland was actually a relatively popular and somewhat successful mayor of Duisburg. People thought he was making things happen in the city. But in the weeks and months after the disaster, he bunkered down in hiding, and many people in Duisburg resented him for this. It really paralyzed the city, because the only question anyone could think of was, why is the Love Parade mayor still in office?
Adolf Sauerland has since become a symbol of an abdication of responsibility, in part due to his catastrophic appearance at the press conference the day after the disaster.
There are many questions with regards to the whys and hows. I am aware of these questions, and I assume that we will answer them at some point, but only after we know the details. Only then will we know who has a responsibility here.
Sauerland repeatedly dodged questions regarding his own responsibility and any political consequences he would be willing to face.
I will continue in my role as mayor of Duisburg. I was elected.
Must the mayor go?
The mayor is out.
I'm going upstairs.
Edith Jakubasa, a Duisburg local, also lost a loved one at the Love Parade. Her daughter Marina was severely injured in the disaster and died in hospital a few days later.
I remember he came here a few days after. Sauerland, our mayor back then. We had a private conversation. He came towards me and fell into my arms. He hugged me and said, Oh God, forgive me. And if my memory is correct, then he went, I didn't want any of this to happen, and I'm so terribly sorry, and I didn't want this. And there I thought to myself, my God, the poor man, he's falling apart. He was a miserable sight. Just a miserable sight. And my feeling was, damn. Something's happened to him, not me. Terrible. Really terrible. He was so incredibly afraid. It was hard to handle.
Schwer auszuhalten.
The biggest question will be, was there political pressure to carry out the Love Parade at any cost? When the disaster happened in 2010, the Ruhr region was the European capital of culture, and the Love Parade its flagship event.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Ms. Jakubasa, hello. It took me a while to get here. There are roadworks going on. I was stuck by the chemical plant.
Right.
It was all blocked. I don't want to talk about expectations. But I still haven't given up hope that the witness testimonies today and tomorrow might bring some clarity to what happened at City Hall and the role Adolf Sauerland played in it.
Good morning, Mr. Sauerland. How are you today?
Good morning, Mr. Sauerland.
Morning.
I hope you slept well.
Please enter for the trial against Dressler et al.
Morning. Please be seated. Mr. Sauerland, were you ever subject to political demands to guarantee the event would take place?
The political demands were spread via the media. I heard about them through the press.
All right. Let's move on to the planning phase. How were tasks and responsibilities allocated?
I set up the project and then forwarded all the documents to the Department of Public Order.
Can you provide the name of the person in charge there?
The head of the Department of Public Order was Wolfgang Rabe. His focus, or the focus of his subordinates, was deciding which department within City Hall should grant the event's official authorization.
What was your role in the planning process?
I didn't take on any operative duties.
Why not?
Because I didn't want to get involved in the authorization process. That was done by those with specialties, as it should be.
How were you informed of the progress of the authorization process, and by whom?
As far as I remember, I had no direct contact person in the work groups. Everything went via Mr. Rabe.
Why was Rabe your only contact person?
At the beginning of the planning phase, it was clear which departments would be involved, namely the Department of Public Order, led by Mr. Rabe. It was unclear which other departments would join at a later stage. But in any case, the Department of Public Order suggested having one lead coordinator, Wolfgang Rabe.
Mr. Sauerland appeared to be someone who rather shockingly delegated everything without being properly informed himself. Or at least that's what he claimed.
The fact that the head of the city didn't keep a close eye on things is baffling. I'll say it again. They were the ones who wanted this event at all costs.
I mean, the mayor was a vocational college teacher by profession. He was allowed to rely on his departments with necessary expertise to do a good job. He didn't have to know everything. In fact, I can only make a criminal accusation if I can say he knew it would go wrong and didn't intervene. Or he delegated to people who were so incompetent that it was organizational negligence.
Let's move on to the day of the event itself. What were your responsibilities that day?
I didn't have any on the day itself. I was just supposed to report on the love parade alongside the organizers once it was over.
So, you had a press conference?
Yes. My responsibility was to say that we were happy the love parade took place in Duisburg, and that there were many visitors, that is, around 1.5 million. But I edited that and said that there were 1.5 million people in the city on that day.
Is 1.5 million visitors correct?
I gave that number because the city had signed a non-disclosure agreement with the organizer Lope event to keep quiet about the true figures. In reality, there were between 200,000 and 250,000 people on site.
When did you find out about that?
Long before the day of the event.
Mr. Sauerland, may we ask how you are now?
I think everything has been said. And I can go home now.
How relieved are you?
Goodbye.
Bye.
The trial began on December 8th and is still in its early stages. It might last 1, 2, or even 3 years. That's inexplicable to us. A trial that lasts so long is absolute torture, not only for the victims, but also for the defendants. Whatever verdict is delivered by the German justice system, we won't be satisfied. It won't be easy because, from the outset, the justice system and the public prosecution are to blame for the fact that the two most responsible individuals are not facing charges. That's Sauerland, the former mayor of Duisburg, and Schaller, the owner of the company that organized the Love Parade.
Estas dos personas que son los máximos responsables de lo que pasó, el fiscal no le acusó. Es decir,
so we feel this dissatisfaction that cannot be put right.
De una insatisfacción que no se puede.
The statute of limitations for prosecuting them has expired.
I think in Spain it would also be difficult to make a mayor responsible for mistakes a subordinate made that he wasn't aware of.
Criminal liability is black and white. It assesses only individual responsibility, not collective responsibility.
It's May 22nd, 2018, the 31st day of hearings. Here's the witness everyone's waiting for, Rainer Schaller. He was the CEO of the company that organized the Love Parade.
Morning, Mr. Schaller.
Hi.
I've got two brief questions. How do you feel about your upcoming testimony?
I'm very happy the trial has finally started, and I think it's important for the relatives and those injured to find out what really happened in Duisburg. The Love Parade was no natural disaster. People made mistakes, and I'm here as a witness to do everything I can to help the case.
What mistakes did Lopevent make? Maybe one day we'll tell it like this. There was a business idea to turn a fitness chain into an international brand. Its name, McFit. Its creator, Rainer Schaller. Annual turnover, 135 million euros. He wanted to bring this idea to masses of young customers, to an event where people looked and felt good. A love parade is no peace march, though. It's business.
Please enter for the trial against Dressler et al.
Good morning, please be seated.
Today, it's fair to say the court session began with a surprise. The judge wished to begin questioning Schaller right away, but Schaller requested permission to address the relatives and victims first. He then took out a piece of paper from his jacket and said he would like to apologize to the victims and offer his condolences. It was clear that Schaller had taken advice from a PR company and played it well.
Uli Klose, thank you for the update.
I'm no expert when it comes to reading body language. But when I see something like that, there's no emotion in it. The whole time, even his hand stayed like this the whole time. Or at the most, like this. When I looked at his face, I saw a couple of worry lines, but overall, he was concentrating very hard. I think he'd have preferred to know the questions well in advance. He was coached.
What?
What's it called, that famous acting method? Did you notice he didn't move? Apart from once, to take a sip.
Yes.
To stay like that for 7 hours must be really difficult.
Yes.
He was acting. This last trip really took a toll on me.
I lost 4 pounds. I have to pay for the energy I summoned. It was emotionally draining. Do you know what I mean?
Because body and soul are connected.
I paid for it. I don't know if there's a connection.
I think so.
You do? I suffered from stress and anxiety. Know what I mean?
It's something we have to do. And I'm doing it. That was never in question. But it's a strain. You pay a price for it.
And what a price.
This
trial is unusual in many ways. One of the biggest peculiarities I perceive is that the trial resembles a committee hearing. What happened? And why? There's less focus on the individual roles of the defendants. It's more like an inquiry into the matter. Which begs the question,
und das bringt umso mehr die Frage auf,
why are the defendants up there?
Die Angeklagten?
Die intensive Aufarbeitung eines so komplexen
the process of investigating such a complex event takes time and effort.
Man muss halt auch sehr tief
you have to go deep into the material.
Aufgrund der Vielzahl der Beweismittel,
because there is such extensive evidence, there are a great number of circumstances to discuss, include and assess.
Mit denen man sich auseinandersetzen muss.
But that's the essence of a criminal trial and has nothing to do with a committee.
Hat mit einem Untersuchungsausschuss
that's not what we are.
Also wir waren kein Untersuchungsausschuss.
Please enter for the case against Dressler et al.
Also ich bin bis zu dem Zeitpunkt, wo die Anklage
until the moment the accusation was filed, I never expected to be part of this trial.
Teil dieser Anklage zu sein, auch wenn ich vielleicht
even though I was part of the preliminary investigation.
Aber es wurde mir
all of a sudden, I realized
They consider me close to circumstances leading to the deaths of young people. And that triggered a striking emotional response in me.
Good morning. Please be seated.
What really got me about this trial, it made me acutely aware of the reality of this disaster through the judge's speeches, through videos and images. And I can openly admit that I sat there and cried. I really felt that these images were unreal, that they couldn't, shouldn't have happened.
It's the 52nd day of hearings, August 7th, 2018. Today will be the hottest day of the year. It's oppressively humid. A storm is brewing. A witness has been called whose testimony is considered highly significant.
Mr. Rabe is here today. He's extremely important because he exchanged emails with various employees at the event's organizing company. He also exercised a certain influence over the defendants who worked at the city's building authority.
We now come to the trial's fundamental contradiction. The mayor had given the strict order in accordance with the municipal code that Rabe would be appointed the Love Parade's project manager. This fact hasn't interested the prosecution or the judge.
It's not that Mr. Dressler's function was taken over entirely by Mr. Rabe, but nor was he informed of every detail. Instead, he was given certain pieces of information which were part of the whole picture. Regardless, we believe that he should have paid closer attention. That was one of our main accusations, that he failed to do so. Who was responsible for what within this project? In my view, the organization of the project was left in its original form. That means Mr. Rabe had the project management role, as my client has maintained. It's important to ask, was that okay? Of course it was. For me, the only question that remains is it okay that my client is up there when someone else may have been in charge? And my answer to that is no.
Mr. Rabe actually admitted that he had pressured members of the Duisburg City Council because he had the feeling that some of them were against approving the Love Parade. He clearly pushed the Love Parade through City Council and sped up the authorization process. The astonishing thing is he doesn't deny it today.
We considered Mr. Rabe to be the main bully behind the project, which made many people ask, why is he not in the dock?
You have to ask who made the most important decisions, which is what the indictment focused on. Take Mr. Rabe, who had a significant role as the Love Parade's coordinator and was among those held responsible. However, he ultimately was not the person who made the final call to go ahead with the project. That responsibility lay with the building authority.
Wolfgang Rabe knew how to force the Love Parade through City Hall, building up pressure and ensuring, as he put it, everyone was on the same track. To dispel the concerns voiced by the building authorities, he employed an external reviewer, the then-renowned traffic researcher Michael Schreckenberg.
How did you find out about Professor Schreckenberg?
Shortly before the World Cup in 2006, Schreckenberg had declared half of the German stadiums to be unsafe. I wanted to prevent something similar happening. For example, that at the last minute he would say the Love Parade could not take place. That's why I wanted to involve him.
If I understand correctly, you chose Schreckenberg because he could have publicly criticized the event at short notice?
Yes, but I didn't want a favorable review from him. I just wanted to involve him early enough. If he'd said it couldn't work, I'd have canceled the event.
That would have been easy.
On May 12, 2010, approximately 2 months before the disaster, you apparently met Mr. Schreckenberg and spoke with him about his job and fee. Where did you meet?
In my office.
Please try to recall how you explained the job to Mr. Schreckenberg.
He wanted to write a review, but there was not enough time. So I told him, we've come quite far with the planning. Take a look at what we have.
Take a look. What did that involve? Did you give him documents? Blueprints? A written concept?
No.
Did you ask him questions?
No, I lack the necessary expertise.
How did you settle on the fee?
My assistant and I agreed that 10,000 euros felt like too little, so we settled on 20,000. If he'd received more work, we'd have discussed his fee again.
Did you have a similar flat rate sum with other contracts?
No.
Then why did you have one for Mr. Schreckenberg?
Because I wanted him on board.
And that was really the tragedy of the employees at the building authority. They had concerns, which they also documented. But in the end, they still approved the event, although they could have decided not to. In my view, Mr. Rabe clearly carries considerable moral responsibility for the disaster, but I still don't consider it criminal. We're in the 8th month of taking evidence, and so far we've heard testimony from many city council employees involved in the event's planning phase. Mr. Rabe concludes this in a way. We will now move on to a series of police officers who helped plan the event and were present that day.
Police officer Torsten Meyer was on duty at the event during the second shift. At around 2 p.m., he made his way to his section. Meyer, the 100 riot officers he supervised, would play a central role on the afternoon of July 24th.
The whole event was characterized by the feeling that the situation was out of control. As soon as we'd figured out how to solve one problem, the next one arose. It was as though the bag of problems that we were carrying around just got heavier and heavier. We took a few steps into the tunnel and received the first call from our section lead, who said we needed to meet with the organizer's crowd manager at the container. There were already problems, and we needed to sync up with each other.
Torsten Meyer's unit is stationed at the tunnel and the lower level of the so-called East Ramp. The ramp is the only entrance to the event grounds. Expert reviewer Professor Gerlach believes the ramp's upper level played a decisive role in the subsequent disaster.
Compared to the locations of the previous love parades in Berlin, Dortmund, and Essen, this site stood out for one reason in particular. It was closed off. On one side was the highway, on the other side the railway tracks. Above it was the central station, and below was the tunnel. So the grounds had to be fenced in. Depending on where you approached from, you ended up at one of these two entry points, the west entrance or the east entrance, both of which had turnstiles. So the entrances were 60 centimeters wide. Then you went through a tunnel. The visitors converged here and went up a ramp from which they saw the grounds for the first time. There was a kind of wow effect, with the freight depot up ahead and the floats driving around. So the top of the ramp became a very concentrated spot. You go up the ramp, and even if you want to keep going, the speed of the floats slows you down. And that causes a reduction in the flow of people at this spot.
The upper part of the east ramp starts to fill up as guests arrive at the beginning of the event. Around 3:30 p.m., the situation at the top of the ramp becomes alarming.
We were standing in the crowd manager's container. The organizer wanted to focus on dispersing the crowds by the entrance up onto the event site at the top of the ramp.
For everything to run according to plan, the float and parade route at this point would have had to be 60 meters wide. In reality, the area's narrowest point was only 28.4 meters wide. That means a backlog was to be expected in that spot at some point. And that's exactly what happened. There was a backlog of people there, which was a decisive trigger for the tragic events that followed.
We then agreed with the organizer to close off the outer entrances simultaneously, so no one else could enter the tunnel from outside and thus approach the ramp.
We had two other focal points, the western turnstiles and, as shown here, the eastern turnstiles. If you take the expected maximum capacity as a basis, all the turnstiles together were still not sufficient. Congestion was effectively built into the design.
At that point, there were lots of people hanging around inside the tunnel. I therefore suggested that instead of setting up a police line on the ramp, we create these barriers inside the tunnel, blocking the ramp. That way, it would be out of view, and people wouldn't be drawn to it. No more people would be crammed into the backs of those already waiting there, and the pressure from below would be reduced.
They then noticed that many guests were already wanting to leave the site. So a third police line was set up between some forgotten fences. The problem was that, because the entrances were too small, people started to get squeezed in at both entry points. The security guards at both the west and east entrances decided to open up again. This was based on the danger they saw, but without taking the entire system into consideration.
Communication in general was a source of a lot of problems. Our radios only worked intermittently, and our phones too. So we had to work with runners to communicate. And then I was told that the unit commanders in the tunnel had said that more and more people were streaming in from outside, which they couldn't understand because the tunnel was supposed to be closed off at both entrances. The crowd pressure increased, and the pressure on the police lines increased. Therefore, when the unit commanders said the police lines wouldn't hold, I thought it was important that we try to use the police lines to drive people towards the ramp in a controlled way, assuming that the problem at the top of the ramp would be solved shortly. That was fundamentally the plan. For the first few meters, it mostly worked. But once the crowds were moving, people just started breaking through the police line at some point, from both sides of the tunnel, towards the ramp.
And now, everyone in there had a huge problem, because the crowd was heading towards the east ramp. And the third police line was standing between two groups of people. The police line came under a lot of pressure and had to be dissolved.
I then came to the conclusion, if you're stuck down there yourself, you'll be powerless. So we climbed up and stayed in the upper area.
Aufgehalten und
trying to influence the situation.
Einfluss zu nehmen auf das Handeln, auf die Lage. Das war der Zugführer, auf der Rampe stand.
The unit commander on the ramp dissolved his police line. He hadn't heard my order over the radio. He did so because of physical pressure from the crowds. Then he tore down fences so that people could get off the ramp over the bank. That freed up the upper area. But the officers down below couldn't see that. At some point, I made eye contact with one of my squad leaders. I indicated that all the people at the bottom of the stairs were no longer looking up, but were just all crammed in.
Und überhaupt nicht mehr nach oben guckten, sondern nur, also sich da irgendwie wie blockiert standen. Hab ihn dann angedeutet, er soll die Person.
I signaled that he should move the people to the upper area.
Und dann guckte er mich an.
And he looked at me
und sagte dann
and just said,
"Full."
Dann habe ich gesagt, and I said, "No." Empty and get them out. I kept radioing that we needed to get everyone over the ramp.
At around 4:30 p.m., the mood on the ramp changed. It was a life-threatening situation. These three, I suppose, magnetic spots, masts, containers, narrow stairway, became the supposed emergency exits, or at least the possible routes to the festival grounds. Some people wanted to go in that direction, others in another, others in yet another. And so there were these wave movements in the crowd. An incredible amount of pressure builds up in these waves. People are lifted up off their feet. They can't breathe. At around 4:49 p.m., you can see that people are struggling to survive.
I kept looking at the stairs near the area where the victims were later found. From where I was standing,
von der eigenen Wahrnehmung,
it looked full.
Ja, es gab Bewegung.
Yes, there was movement.
Es wirkte von oben,
but from up there, it looked problematic, not deadly.
Nicht tödlich. Und als dann die ersten Informationen kamen,
and when we were first informed that people had died, I couldn't believe it.
Hier liegen Tote, konnte ich das gar nicht glauben.
Und die Gruppen, when the squad leader told me, I thought, you must be mistaken, that can't be true.
Das geht doch nicht. Und für mich hat sich da so innerlich
and internally that tore me up.
Und das hat mir nachher sehr zu schaffen.
This image formed that I had watched while people died.
Zugeguckt, wie Menschen gestorben sind.
I mean, I didn't see it. I couldn't see it.
Ich hab's nicht gesehen.
But this voice in my head said, "You watched as people died."
Du hast zugeguckt, wie Menschen gestorben sind. Letztendlich war für mich persönlich meine Vernehmung.
Being questioned during the trial was very significant for me, because it was important to me that I tell the victims and survivors how endlessly sorry I am for what happened.
Leid mir das alles tut, was da passiert ist, weil einfach ja als Mensch.
As a human being.
Ich bin ja selber.
I'm a father myself. I have a daughter who's almost 18 and a 13-year-old stepson.
Und wenn man sich vorstellt,
when I imagine sending them to an event where you trust everything to work and then they don't return,
die kommen dann nicht wieder. Also das ist ja menschlich.
On a human level, that is unbelievably tragic.
Aber auch als Polizist.
And as a policeman, you want everything to be safe. People trust you.
Und dass wir es nicht geschafft haben, diese Folgen zu verhindern.
But we didn't prevent this. And I keep thinking about what I could have done differently.
Was ist falsch gewesen?
What went wrong?
Deswegen fand ich auch für mich dann.
So for me, in retrospect, the trial has been an important milestone in processing what happened.
Wichtigen Meilenstein auch in der Verarbeitung.
As part of the report, simulations of crowd flows were created to illustrate the events of the day. You can also use these simulations to see what else might have happened. For example, one of them looks at what would have happened without any police lines. The simulation shows that a standstill on both sides would almost certainly have been reached, and the bottleneck would have been as large as it was on the day of the event. The crowd density is evident in the simulation, even without police lines.
Might the Love Parade trial end long before the statute of limitations? After 14 months of hearings and 31 so-called alpha witnesses, comes a surprising turn of events.
After less than 100 days in court, is it all over? This is the question surrounding the Love Parade trial today. Many lawyers involved believe the court may consider closing the case early. This would be possible if the culpability of the 10 defendants is not significant enough to convict them of negligent homicide.
On January 16th, 2019, the legal professionals involved in the trial talk in private for many hours. Even the victim's relatives have to wait outside. Will the conditions for the end of the Love Parade trial be decided today?
The result of the legal consultation was that we suggested to the defense that the case be closed for the 6 city council members and 1 employee of the event's organizing company. In our opinion, their culpability, even if proven with certainty later on, would still be minimal. We also suggested closing the case against the 3 remaining employees from the organizing company with a settlement of 10,000 euros.
Der Vorsitzende Richter hat gleich zu Beginn der Verlesung seines Vermerks darauf hingewiesen, dass
the presiding judge emphasized right at the beginning of his reading the significance of the consequences brought about by the Love Parade disaster in 2010.
Dennoch muss das Gericht
nonetheless, the court must consider all relevant individual circumstances when assessing the defendant's personal culpability. Here the judge explained that multi-causality comes into play, that multiple independent factors were responsible for what happened.
Für das Geschehnis verantwortlich sein kann, hier von Bedeutung ist.
The court has only made suggestions until now. They will not come into force until the defendants and prosecution agree to them. Public opinion, however, is already being shaped.
It's clear that this is difficult to deal with emotionally. But legally, the court's decision can be explained.
The plaintiff's attorneys will now at least try to get their client's costs reimbursed. However, the decision to accept or reject the court's offer to close the case must be taken by the prosecution and the defendants, not the plaintiffs.
The truth is that in Germany, the criminal justice system is not equipped to handle such mammoth cases.
This trial won't be able to heal the mistakes that were made. But that's not my fault. We predicted this would happen thousands of times. This is truly a joke.
So?
Well, let me just say something. We have 3 objectives.
What did he say?
The first objective was an explanation. The second is compensation. And the third is sentencing. But here, we won't be successful.
Yeah, I see.
The court gives the prosecution and defendants 3 weeks to react to the proposals agreed upon during the legal consultation. Further questioning of witnesses will continue until the deadline on February 5th. Then, on the 98th day in court, comes another unexpected development.
Today, a defense lawyer representing an employee from the organizing company came forward. He told the court that he and his client opposed the closing of the case. He emphasized that this applies to both proposals, both with and without a financial settlement.
I can very well imagine that he finds the way he was treated and the charges themselves quite unfair. The story that Lopevent has been repeating since the disaster is the police were to blame. It was the police's fault. And I think that he and the other defendants have really started to believe this.
When a case is closed because of the statute of limitations, the state carries the costs incurred by the defendant too. For example, his lawyer fees. But if it's closed against the settlement, then the defendant must cover the lawyer fees. Sometimes the defendant may even be charged the plaintiff's legal fees.
Und wenn Sie jetzt mal hochrechnen,
in one case, these were around 140,000 euros in expenses and travel costs.
140,000 euro ungefähr geltend gemacht.
That adds up.
Dann kann man vielleicht auch besser verstehen,
with this in mind, you can understand why, why the defendant didn't want to settle.
Dass eine Einstellung gegen Auflagen hatten.
I feel that for some of the relatives and survivors, there is no possible satisfactory outcome. I can't imagine what it would look like, how a verdict would achieve that. Whatever happens, it won't feel right.
Morning.
Morning.
Wish me luck.
Ich bin ja.
Within the city's management, I'm the only person who's ended up in the dock. That might be because they found enough reasons to put me there. Over time, I've made my peace with this. Since there's one thing I can say for sure. My five co-defendants from the council, who used to be my subordinates, deserve this even less than I do. Nothing can happen to me. I can retreat back into the shadows of retirement. This realization gives me a sense of peace, of closure.
After exactly 101 trial days, six defendants from Duisburg City Council and one from the Love Parade's organizer can return home without paying a settlement. The prosecution and court believe their culpability is too minimal for a conviction. However, three other defendants from the organizer Lopevent must still account for the deaths of 21 people. The Love Parade trial goes on.
Our client is innocent. And the decision to close the case reflects this. It was an easy decision, and there was no settlement. It is good and just that his innocence has at last been confirmed today.
I can understand that the 10 defendants cannot be held fully responsible for the disaster. I can recognize that. There were some very different people involved.
Of course, it's much easier when you have one guilty party to blame for everything, where you can say they did it. And now we can punish that person with the full weight of the law. But this incident and the charges of negligent homicide and bodily harm don't work like that. We've had to deal with this dilemma the entire time.
I can see that, but it hurts regardless, you know? We all hoped for a different outcome.
Last night when I got home, my wife of 40 years took me in her arms and really sobbed. And when his wife cries, this old man cries his eyes out too.
Thank you.
In its 15th month, the Love Parade trial has reached a difficult stage. Public interest in the trial has greatly declined, and the media bear the reports on it.
Please enter for the case against...
The district court is continuing the trial with the same schedule of evidence as planned.
Good morning. Please be seated.
More aspects will be clarified. But the fact is, the witnesses deemed most important have already been questioned. It's possible, therefore, that little further information will emerge from those still to come.
In the summer and fall of 2019, the court calls as witnesses the trial's former defendants. The creative director of the Love Parade, as well as the building authority's department head and his employees. They all give their versions of events. Finally, a number of former Lope Event employees are questioned, stewards, float drivers, and security personnel.
Many Lope Event witnesses didn't want to remember things and openly said they didn't want to testify. There was a remarkable number of gaps in knowledge in certain areas. Any questions regarding Lope Event's internal procedures were met with, "I don't remember anymore. I don't know. I can't speak to this." But when they addressed potential or confirmed mistakes committed by the police, the witnesses suddenly had detailed information. That was conspicuous.
Nevertheless, the testimonies of the Lope Event employees gradually form a picture. The final Love Parade was unique because it took place on a fenced-in site. However, the construction law which applied to the event did not contain binding regulations for all the planning details.
The legal and organizational regulations for event planning and implementation were most likely incomplete back then. The organizers developed a safety concept which seems to have met the required standard at the time.
There have been regulatory changes in the planning of events since 2010. However, on the points relevant here, there have been no new laws, regulations, or technical rules.
New technical rules are required at Duisburg's district court as well. In the trial's 28th month, the novel coronavirus catches up with the proceedings. At the same time, the court has a new proposal.
Good afternoon, everyone.
Good afternoon.
I won't shake your hands for obvious safety reasons. Today, the court has proposed closing the case entirely.
They're using the pandemic as an excuse to end the trial. Everyone goes home and no one is held accountable. No single person or group of people is responsible for what happened. It's a scandal.
In July, the case expires. But instead of waiting until then, they're using the coronavirus as an excuse to say, let's stop it now. What does this achieve? The trial is over and we can't file an appeal. What's more, we're in lockdown in Spain and can't go there to give them our opinion.
Closing the case would likely have been proposed with or without COVID, since the judges perceive the defendants to have minimal culpability, as court spokesman Matthias Breidenstein explains.
A main factor behind this decision is the judges' recognition that the tragic events had multiple causes and that they compounded each other. It wasn't the defendants' actions alone that caused the disaster.
To close the case without a verdict or acquittal only requires that the defendants and the public prosecutors agree, which they have done.
For me,
this is an unworthy ending. as we've not yet heard from the expert reviewer. For me and many other relatives, I believe that's a very important element.
The fact that the court has eliminated the possibility of questioning the expert is very disappointing and an unworthy end to this trial. Good morning. Please be seated. The particularity of this trial is that it was not limited to the incidents of one day. The event had a very long preliminary planning phase in which many institutions were involved, who all contributed intensively. Particularly when you're measuring the individual culpability of a defendant, you can't ignore what other institutions did.
Und insofern brauchen wir den großen Überblick über das Ganze.
You need a broad overview of the whole case, so you can eventually determine what the cause was.
Waren die Angeklagten daran schuld?
You must ask, were the defendants to blame? And then perhaps the most difficult question of all, if so, how large was their individual guilt? The causes of this disaster are complex and multiple. The defendants didn't act carelessly. They all made intense efforts to organize a safe event. And ultimately, we must, of course, recognize that they didn't manage to do so. The disaster occurred 10 years ago, and the court is convinced that the trial has left a strong impression on the defendants. It was emotionally draining for them, as well as for the joint plaintiffs.
So it's not over for you?
No. I need to process all of this, including everything I've heard these last hours. I need to let it sink in first. I can't just say, that's how it is, and flip the switch and everything's fine.
The
outrage that is still felt today is not so much directed at the defendants.
Der große Scherbenhaufen.
I really believe that the big mess created right after the disaster was too much for any trial to sweep away. How would things be different today if, right after the disaster or in the weeks that followed, everyone who had sought to profit from the event had stood up and set things straight?
Wirklich den Rücken danach gerade gemacht hätten.
I don't think there'd be this bitter taste that's been left behind now that the case has been closed.
It was an organized lack of responsibility, if you like. There were many institutions involved, but it wasn't clear who was responsible for what. That is what we believe led in large part to the disaster.
That there is a political area of responsibility outside of the trial has not been made clear, unfortunately. The trial covered up a lot that should have been investigated intensively with a different approach. The state parliament should have organized a committee of inquiry.
I would say that many politicians hoped this district court trial would bring some sense of peace.
Yes, that the court would take on the task. The politicians thought, the court will take that on for us.
The decision to close the case is final. The only thing we could do is to go to Strasbourg, to the European Court of Human Rights. Article 6 of the European Convention on Human Rights guarantees a fair trial for all members of the Council of Europe. Is it fair not to finish a trial? Is it fair to have a trial without a verdict, be it guilty or not guilty? To us, it's not only unfair, it's not even a trial. because it never came to an end.
I had a path which I intended to take, and now it's come to an end here. And I'll accept that. It's the way it is. I really think I've come to a point where I have to accept that. It ends here.
From the court standpoint, the Love Parade disaster has been explained. That said, we were not in a position to identify a villain such as you might find in a disaster film. Someone who acted out of self-interest and ignored all the warnings.
At this point, no stone has been left unturned. What else is left? What questions remain? As we have neither murderers nor killers in the dock, it's certainly possible that a trial like this can end without a verdict. It would be foolish to believe that a constitutional system of justice functions only if someone is convicted. On the contrary, we hold a trial to find out if someone should be convicted.
The session is closed.